Welcome, everybody. I'm Aaron Simmons, and this is Two Philosophers, One Conversation, where we remind each other that philosophy has always been about the public good, and we have got to do our best to make meaning in light of the fact that we are mortal beings. I am joined today by an absolutely amazing philosopher, an amazing speaker, somebody who's a New York Times bestseller, Tom Morris. Tom started his career as a professor in philosophy at Notre Dame, and then realized that the world needed the kind of value that philosophers bring to the table, and started launching out, speaking to corporations and different companies and civic organizations, and eventually really found his stride in that space, and then started writing enormous numbers of books. Really, I've lost track of how many, Tom. In fiction, philosophical fiction, books such as, you know, Socrates of Silicon Valley, and If Aristotle Ran General Motors, and recently an amazing book called Plato's Lemonade Stand about how we can stir change into something great. So Tom is a widely sought after speaker, speaks and consults often with Fortune 500 companies, has traveled around the world, and now is gracious enough to speak with us and think with us from his home in Wilmington, North Carolina. So Tom, thanks so much for being with us today.
Oh, Aaron, it's great to be with you. You're one of my favorite philosophers in the world, so this is a real treat for me.
Well, I told you earlier on that one of the great things about starting this interview series during a quarantine is that philosophers who are too important and too powerful and too expensive to do these sorts of things are saying yes because they're bored.
So yeah, we've got nothing to do, you know.
I appreciate that your boredom has reached the level where you would be willing to do this with me. So, Tom, thanks so much for being with us. I'd love to start today simply by thinking with you about the role of philosophy in public life. Your career has taken a rather distinctive arc. It doesn't look the way that most of ours has. In fact, you were a tenured professor, full professor at Notre Dame, the gold standard. You had arrived. You had won the lottery. And then basically shifted gears entirely and left that position to go out and start this kind of public philosophical presence that you've then now been doing for 20 years or more. Maybe say a little bit about what it is that a public philosopher is what good the public philosopher offers for human society.
Well, it was this wonderful, unexpected opportunity. And I've almost come to think that any great opportunity in our lives tends to be unexpected. Mm. I grew up in a tiny little 800 square foot rented house in Durham, North Carolina. Nobody in my family had ever gone to college on either side of the family. And my senior year in high school, my mother said, "There's no money for college, so figure out what kind of job you want to do." I thought, wow, we had truck drivers, we had farmers, we had a NASCAR mechanic, we had all kinds of people in the family, but no college folks. Mm. And I got a letter in the mail one day. I'd been nominated for a Morehead scholarship to go to UNC Chapel Hill, absolutely all expenses paid. And we had to call people to find out what that was all about. We didn't know. So I went to Carolina for free, the other Carolina, University of North Carolina. I went to and being a Morehead scholar got me a free ride at Yale for graduate school. So I did two PhDs over 6 years, and it never cost anything. That was remarkable. And then to start my career at a place like Notre Dame was just unbelievable in my specialty of philosophy of religion. And I quickly wrote 10 books and 50 essays, and I was just tearing up the road in philosophy of religion, discovering new things and thinking, oh, this is what I'm going to do the rest of my life. This is awesome. Mm-hmm. And one day I got a call from the local Chamber of Commerce. Tom, we're doing a session this year on ethics for young leaders in the community, and we really want you to come and give us a talk about the ethics of decision making. We've heard that your classes at Notre Dame are so popular. You teach an eighth of the student body most years. You have these giant classes. Could you do a session for us on ethics? And rather than saying, well, I've never studied ethics, that's not my specialty, I don't teach on it at Notre Dame, rather than saying that, I said, well, okay, let me look into it. You know, I'll be happy to try. So I read all the new business books that were out at the time. You know, Iacocca, guess what? The Art of the Deal by Donald Trump, Zig Ziglar, all these people. And I was learning what I could build on and what I had to resist in my talk on ethics. So I gave a little talk on the ethics of decision making. And practically everybody in that room of about 100 people said, you got to come to my church, you got to come to my real estate company, you got to come to my bank. All of a sudden, I was going all over South Bend, Indiana, and I was giving free talks. I didn't know there was a business of being a public speaker. I was just trying to build bridges between the university and the rest of the world. And that turned into this huge enterprise 30 years later that I'm still doing. It was just amazing, the unexpected adventures that life has for us.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And you've been able then to take the philosophical wisdom that you were teaching your students and simply expand it out to a broader audience, which
absolutely
ultimately is the goal, right?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, shortly after that Chamber of Commerce talk, an Oldsmobile dealer called me up and said, we have this Midwest regional meeting every year with speakers, well-known athletes and people like that, and they give motivational talks, and they all basically say the same thing. Set goals, believe in yourself, you can do it. Did the great philosophers look more deeply into a topic like success? And I said, well, that's not the kind of stuff I studied in graduate school. Let me look into it.
Yes.
So throughout my career, if I didn't know about something, I wouldn't say, no, I'm the wrong guy for that. I don't know anything about that. I would say, well, let me look into it. And I put together a little talk on success, the wisdom for success. And that's basically the talk that kind of shot me around the world. Everybody wants more wisdom for their lives. It's like, if I can bring people the ideas that have stood the test of time, not just what worked for Steve Jobs, not just what worked for Bill Gates, not just what worked for Pepsi-Cola or Coca-Cola, what's always worked for people in the best of times, in the worst of times? What are the things about human nature that the wisest people who've ever lived have learned that we can use in our lives now? I mean, as a philosopher, I didn't know, but as soon as you think about it, you say, well, that's kind of obvious. Who wouldn't want to know about that, right? So all of a sudden I had rooms of 10,000 people I was talking to, or 5,000 people, and get a chance to be on Regis and Kathy Lee and the Today Show and CNN International, and not a career trajectory that any philosopher ever prepares for. Because it's an interesting thing. Early on, people say, well, can you make a business out of this? And I said, well, look, it's about impact first. And then income. I mean, I have to support my family and everything, but I just want to make a difference in the world. And early on, I thought to myself, you know, people buy two kinds of things. They buy what they want, and they buy what they need. And everybody needs philosophy, so surely everybody's going to buy philosophy if it's available out there. Well, I came to realize, no, it's not that quite that simple. People do buy what they want, but they don't necessarily buy what they need. They buy what they think they need.
Yeah.
So my job with a lot of companies was to convince them that they had a need. The Washington Speakers Bureau, through whom I spoke exclusively for about 16 years with all the political honchos in the country, they said to me, you're the hardest speaker we've ever had to sell initially, but you're the easiest to resell. And I said, why is that? They said, when we say this guy's a philosopher, a lot of people say, wow, that's not relevant to our business. But then when they hear what you talk about, they say, oh, you got more of this? We want more of this, you know? So that's the cool thing about being a philosopher. It's not like, you know, I study insect species in ancient Babylon, and maybe people aren't interested in that, you know? Right. But it's like, we study human nature. We study what happiness is all about, what success is all about, and how to handle frustration in your life, and how to deal with your emotions so that your emotions are wiser. They don't take you off track, but they keep you on track. Those kind of things everybody's interested in. And, you know, who knew as a philosophy graduate student that I'd be doing this? But now that I am doing it, it seems the most natural thing in the world.
Yeah. Well, and one of the things that I find so compelling about your own story is it actually speaks to the way that I wish all philosophers and philosophy departments were marketing what they do and why they do it. Too often we seem to think the way that we will justify the relevance of philosophy is by transforming it into the things that people think they want, rather than being really good at transforming what people think they want into what they really need.
Yeah.
And so it's almost like we have to activate the norms that lie dormant in their own preference, right?
Yeah, that's right.
And I tell my students all the time that philosophy is the most practical discipline they will ever study, because whatever job they have, whatever they do with their lives, wherever their lives take them, they will still remain embedded in the human condition.
Yeah.
And so they probably should think pretty well about that, right?
Yeah.
And it's funny, during this current pandemic and being quarantined, I've had several students reach out to me and say, look, I've withdrawn from all of my classes because I've got enough to graduate and I don't want to have to mess with the online stuff.
Yeah.
And they'd say, but I'm staying in your class because it's the only one that seems relevant to my life right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm like, my goodness, how is it that we are not expressing that message,
right,
you know, to the world, to their parents most times, right, who are saying, right, well, you can take the philosophy course if you major in business or if you major in something practical.
Right, right.
You know, like,
right,
my goodness, what is more practical than thinking well about where we are, where we're trying to go, and why it matters that we do it, right?
I know, and so many people have tried over the last few decades to justify the study of philosophy only because of the critical thinking aspect. You know, you can analyze things better. You're not as vulnerable to fallacious rhetoric. You know, it's like intellectual self-defense. And yeah, that's a part of it.
Yeah.
But there's so much more, especially as we now, and I've had this wonderful joy for the last 30 years of being one of the first people to kind of rediscover the practical side of philosophy, the kind of forgotten side, because more than 100 years, we started as philosophers emulating the natural sciences. We got more technical. We got more analytical. We built up sort of abstruse vocabularies that we would use to signal each other as to what we were talking about or plugging into a literature. And that pushed us farther and farther to the periphery of the culture. But philosophy, as it was viewed in the ancient world, as a way of life, as a way of grappling with the challenges and opportunities of every day, when we can bring that back to people, when we can rediscover that whole side of philosophy, things get very exciting. So I often call myself a practical philosopher, and people think that's a sort of an oxymoron, you know, it's a contradictory thing. No, not at all. Yeah. Theory is supposed to serve practice. Right. And so as a philosopher now, I'm confronted with what people are going through, and especially in our time right now, an ancient image has come back to me many times recently. The image of your life as a big wagon wheel, you know, the old wagon wheels, and time as the bumpy road down which the wheel is rolling. Now, the image is, imagine yourself as a tiny little creature living somewhere on this wheel. If you live out toward the outer edge, toward the rim, then as the wheel turns, you'll be whipped up and down to high highs and low lows. You'll experience irrational exuberance. Then you'll experience terrible depression. And as the wheel turns, you're just going to be disoriented all the time, right? You're going to have these great days and these terrible days. And the philosophers have taught me that we can move ourselves toward the hub of the wheel, and the wheel's still going to turn, but we won't be whipped about so dramatically, and that wisdom is precisely what moves us in toward the hub, which is a place of real peace and power for dealing with the ups and downs of life. You know, I get this from Boethius's Consolations of Philosophy. I get this from a lot of the great thinkers in the past, that life is going to throw everything imaginable at us. It always has. You know, we live in difficult times. Well, so is everybody else.
Yep.
So why not draw on the wisdom of the wisest people who've ever confronted this kind of stuff before us? And rather than trying to make it up for ourselves, you know, stand on the shoulders of giants. I mean, if you wanted to go get into tennis, learn a new sport like tennis or basketball or football, and somebody said, okay, you can figure it out yourself, or I'll bring into town all the greatest people still alive who've ever played this sport, and you can get their advice. Which would you prefer to do?
Right.
You know, who would say, nah, I'm good. Yeah, I'm good. No thanks, you know. Michael Jordan, nah, don't need him, you know.
Yeah.
So that's what we're doing with the philosophers. We're saying, let's get the advice of all these amazing people who fought through really similar circumstances, because really, no matter how much human technology has changed, human nature is the same as it's always been. You can read from any culture, from the Tao Te Ching, you can read from the Analects of Confucius, from the Roman Stoic philosophers, you can draw from any cultural wisdom tradition and get basically the same deep insights about how to handle life. And so that's kind of become my business.
Yeah, well, it's a business that clearly has been good to you, but it's also been good for so many in the world and so many in the audience. I mean, it reminds me, of course, you know, Aristotle has this idea that true wisdom is a practical mode of engagement, that it's a phronetic kind of wisdom instead of just a theoretical kind of wisdom. And it's really funny, of course, he says that if we really had our druthers, if everything were perfect, well, then, yeah, we philosophers would sit around and do theory all day long because it, you know, floats our boats and makes us
excited. Right.
But the problem is we never get to the point in life where we get to stop living or suspend living to be able to engage in that kind of thinking. That in fact, we're always, as Kierkegaard reminds us, we are always amidst the very ship that we're trying to make sense of, right? You can't stop existing to think about how to exist more effectively. Yeah. One of the things that I find especially compelling about your work, and I know you talked about this in your latest book, Plato's Lemonade Stand, we'll have links in the description for the listeners, is that in times of difficulty, times of change, times of unease and disruption of our normal mode, that's when real innovation happens. That's when real progress can emerge. We right now find ourselves as a global society, right? It's bigger than America. It's bigger than the West. It's, we are all in this together. Yeah. And being in this together in light of the pandemic, everyone, it seems, is having to rethink what counts as normal and how we're going to go forward. But it seems to me that in light of the work you've done, that this is actually one of those moments we would never desire or wish for. But given that we are now in this space, that real innovation, real progress, real transformation of human engagement might be possible. Yeah. How would you encourage people now who are facing that frustration and nihilism and anxiety? What is the practical philosophical wisdom they can draw on for how to move forward right now?
Well, that's one of the reasons I wrote this book, Plato's Lemonade Stand. I grew up hearing everybody say, when life hands you lemons, make lemonade. I must have heard that hundreds of times as a kid, but nobody said how. So one day it occurred to me, I wonder if the philosophers said anything about how we should do this. Actually, a company had asked me to come and give them a talk on dealing with difficult change. They were being bought by a bigger company, and they said the day the sale goes through, our boss gets $24 million, and the rest of us don't know if we have a job or not. Wow. And so I put together a talk for these 750 people on dealing with difficult change, and one lady afterwards told me she had been an Olympic swimmer. And she said, you said in 45 minutes what my coach was trying to say for 15 years and could never quite articulate. And I said, well, the philosophers have taught me that the worst of times can lead to the best of times. In my own life, that's true. The toughest things I've ever gone through have been transformative and have opened me up to the best things I was capable of going through. So yes, we regret suffering and we try to alleviate it. But somehow, always as a side effect, if we do it right, we end up getting better and getting deeper and getting wiser. And so is there an ability? See, for 20 years in the business world, people have been talking about resilience. You experience something really hard and you bounce back. For 10 years, they've been talking about another quality that Angela Duckworth at Pennsylvania calls grit, the ability to kind of persevere and soldier on. But the lemons to lemonade advice isn't just about bouncing back to where you were. It's not just about gritting your teeth and soldiering on. It's about somehow going from difficulty to delight. It's about going from a hard situation into something really good. So how do you do that? And the more I studied it, and I worked on the book for 15 years, I rewrote it 25 times. It had 5 different titles. Talk about difficult change. I was living the advice as I brought it to people. But and I couldn't get this book published. I couldn't get it finished. I couldn't get it published. I wanted it to be out for the Great Recession, and it just wouldn't allow me to finish it for some reason. And then it came out just 2 months ago. And people have said, how did you know that this would be the time of all times that we needed this book? And I said, I didn't know. But often this is the way things work. There's a spiritual capability we have. I like to use the ancient metaphor of alchemy. You know, the alchemists were said to be people trying to turn base metals into gold or regular lives into eternal lives, the elixir of life. And what the alchemists were really all about is radical transformation of the ordinary into the extraordinary, of the difficult into the great. And the philosophers have left us amazing wisdom about how to do that. And that's how I wrote the book. And that's how in my own life, you know, they would say things like, calm down, the Stoics would say. Hardly anything in this world is as good as it seems or as bad as it seems. So let's just chill out a little bit. And there's this image that came to me one day when I was writing a previous book, a short novel called The Oasis Within. A CEO in California of a global organization told me pages 5 and 6 of that book changed his life forever. And I thought, really? So I had to go back and look at pages 5 and 6. What's up there?
What is it I said?
Yeah, and so the book is set in Egypt in 1934, and a group of guys are across in the desert, and there's an old man with his nephew, his young nephew, and they're talking about they're leaving an oasis, and the boy says, "Wow, I wish we could stay in this oasis." And the old man says, "Well, you can carry an oasis with you wherever you go in life." And the boy says, "Well, how's that?" And so they start talking about it. And at one point in the conversation, on page 5 and 6, the old man says, "Look, have you ever seen a telescope?" And the boy says, "Yeah, not too long ago, a guy was in my village with a telescope. Look, you remember the old pirate telescope, the old spyglass you'd hold up and look through?" And the old man said, "Well, when I was a boy, somebody gave me one. I looked through the little end that everybody looks through. It made everything big and close, made everything look much more imposing than it was. And then I thought to turn the telescope around and look through the big end that nobody was looking through. And all of a sudden, it shrank things down to size. It made giant trees look tiny and close people look far away." And the boy said, "Well, I never thought to look through the big end." And the old man says, "Well, we have a kind of in our minds and hearts an emotional telescope. And whenever anything bad happens, we look through the little end like everybody, and we make it look bigger than it is, and closer, and more imposing, more daunting. We can turn that telescope around. We can look through the other end and shrink things down to size and give ourselves some breathing room and a sense that I'm big enough to confront this new situation, however big it looked a minute ago." And the boy said, "Wow, I never thought about that." And the old man said, "And here's the ultimate secret. Once you've learned the truth of perspective, you can end up putting your telescope down. Mm-hmm. And look at things as they truly are, knowing you have enough greatness of soul and spirit to be able to confront whatever is thrown in your path." And the boy says, "Wow, I like that idea." So the philosophers have these things for us, these matters of wisdom and perspective. And I've really come to think that wisdom is often just about perspective. Mm-hmm. That in times like this, we're going to be so innovative. We're going to be so creative. A famous psychologist said to me yesterday on the Zoom session, he said, "I think 6 months from now, we're going to look back at this period as the most creative in modern times, because we've been forced out of our comfort zones and we're having to innovate and create, and we're unleashing the human spirit in a new way." Now, does that compensate for the suffering of the doctors and nurses we're hearing from on the evening news? We wouldn't wish that on anybody. The people suffering this terrible disease, the people whose lives are being cut short by it. No, we wouldn't want this or wish this situation on ourselves at all, but confronted with it, we can do amazing things. And that's what the philosophers have always reassured us.
Yeah, it's wonderful advice. And of course, it's hard to remember when the world looks like it's falling, right?
You
tend to duck and cover rather than look up and say, "Well, shoot, if I just pay attention, I can step aside and let the rock miss me." You know, three things trigger in what you just said. One is, it reminds me of C.S. Lewis, who once said that when he looked around for what to do with his life, he went where no one else was standing in line because he figured that was where work needed to be done.
That's good.
I think right now we're I've got students who are, you know, they're having internships canceled and jobs that they were getting ready to go into are being rescinded, and grad schools are not sure they're going to be able to allow them admission and give them funding. And as all of this is happening, they reach out to me in utter anxiety and utter frustration. And I, of course, try to affirm them in the legitimacy of those experiences and those feelings. But then I always try to say, "But look, what you were doing was the thing that seemed obvious to you as what you ought to be doing.
Right.
Right now, you've got this amazing opportunity, given that the world is a mess. And again, like you say, we wouldn't want this, but given that this is where we are, you've got this opportunity to think not just about what's obvious for you to do, but what is it that needs doing?"
Yeah.
And that's a fundamentally different way to look at things, right? Which is the perspective. Second thought that it reminds me of is philosopher Todd May, who I actually interviewed on Two Philosophers, One Conversation a couple weeks ago. Todd suggests that all of philosophical wisdom at some level can be boiled down to being able to distinguish between big stuff and small stuff. And being able to then spend the emotional energy for big stuff requires that we not have exhausted it on small stuff. Right? And it turns out, well, this is so trivial and it's obvious, but yet David Foster Wallace famously says that it's where the obvious things lie that the life and death importance happen, because they're the things that propel us behind the scenes that we don't often take the time to investigate and inquire and consider. So what you're suggesting, you know, it sounds to me that it's not just resonant with a particular space, but it's something that invites us into this remembrance, maybe, that even though the world has changed, we fundamentally haven't, right?
Right.
What mattered then continues to matter now.
Absolutely. And it's funny, I did a little drawing the other day for a completely different purpose, but I just noticed it on my desk. Can you see this all right?
Yep.
Imagine you're out in the woods on a hike and you're leading a group of people. And I've told the story many times. You set as your goal to get to the highest point in the area from which you'll be able to survey all the surrounding terrain. And from where you stand, it looks like it's Hill A. So you lead the group up Hill A.
Yep.
To get to your goal of being at the highest spot, well, you get to the summit, and it's a difficult climb, and everybody trips and falls. You help each other back up. Finally, you get to the top, from which vantage point you can now see the much higher Hill B.
Yeah.
Now, if your goal is to get to the highest point in the area, and there you stand on top of Hill A, what's the first thing you're going to have to do? You're going to have to go downhill.
And
if you're leading the group, you're going to have to say, okay, we got to go downhill. And if that group is like almost any group, people go say, what do you mean we have to go downhill? It took us a long time to get up here. Hill A is perfectly good. We can see a lot from where we already are. My point in so many business talks for years now has been to say to people, there's so many businesses, people, families stuck on top of Hill A because nobody wants to go downhill, metaphorically meaning changing what you've most recently been doing. But it's only when we're willing to go downhill from the first success we've had that we can climb a much higher and loftier Hill B. Now, initially, as we go down Hill A, it'll look like we're getting farther from our true goal, right? That's what I love about this image. We get outside our comfort zone. What the point you just made about your students being derailed.
Yeah.
I love the image of being derailed. Yeah. It's almost like we all think we're trains on tracks.
Yeah.
We've got the track laid out for us. We've worked until this point in our lives to lay out this track. What we don't realize is we're not trains on tracks. We're all-terrain vehicles. You know, and so if we're derailed, that doesn't stop our progress.
Yeah.
It can be actually what liberates us to explore. And my dad, in growing up, my father was a very wise person, and I love the advice he gave me over the years. One of his most important pieces of advice was life is supposed to be a series of adventures. The one you've been on is preparing you for the next one, sometimes in ways you can't even imagine. And I think a lot of us are seeing that now, right? That we have skill sets that we didn't know how we could use these skill sets in creative ways that we're. It's like the world is this big kaleidoscope of patterns that changes constantly. You know, Heraclitus in 500 BC was saying the world is always changing. Everything is always changing. Well, what would he say now? I mean, it's like, I told you so or something, right? So it's like the people who can spot the new patterns in the kaleidoscope and act on those patterns are people who flourish. And that's one thing I've been reminding people. In every terrible time of human history, there have been some people who didn't just survive. Right. They actually flourished. How can we be amongst those people? Let's learn from their wisdom. Let's see those patterns in that kaleidoscope. Let's take action. Let's don't be deer in the headlights. Let's take action. Little steps in positive ways to help other people could look very different from the career we had in mind, but it could lead us to things that we couldn't even have imagined.
Yeah. Well, what would you say then to the person who suggests, look, what we've got to do is not go back downhill to get to Hill B, but what we need to do is simply set up a PR firm about why Hill A is in fact the best hill that there is.
Right.
And I ask this because one of the things that I increasingly am worried about right now in this crisis is what I would describe as a kind of lack of moral leadership, right?
Yeah, you're right.
And one of the things that is so seductive and so tempting about power is that we like to be able to then reinforce power by maintaining a kind of status quo. If things don't change, those who are powerful remain in power.
Right.
When you engage in change, what might happen is that the powerful actually lose power and the dispossessed gain certain types of status. So, you know, think about it. The people on top of Hill A, they might say, shoot, we should be going to Hill B, but they look around and they're like, my goodness, look at all the fools in the valley. We're better than all of them, right?
Right.
So how do we avoid this seductive temptation to complacency
at
the level of reinforcing where we are because it's comfortable.
Yeah, it's funny how we human beings are storytellers. We always have been, always will be. So that's why some of the great philosophers, their most effective ideas were expressed in vivid stories, right? And so if we can tell each other stories about what happens when people stay on top of Hill A, and a great story about that is the first big best-selling business book, In Search of Excellence by Tom Peters. He profiled, what was it, like a dozen excellent companies, you know? And then years later, he was shocked when pretty much all of them went out of business. They had terrible problems. They ceased to exist. And he had a kind of a self-knowledge moment. He said, was I that wrong in the companies I profiled as excellent? Could I have possibly gotten it all that wrong? And so what he did is he looked into the history of the companies between the time he had researched and profiled them and the time they went out of business. Mm. And he basically said, arrogance and complacency set in. They thought they knew everything. They didn't need to listen to experts. They didn't need to listen to prophets and philosophers and psychologists. And they didn't need to be on the lookout for innovative and creative people. They thought they knew it all. And so they stayed right on top of what I call Hill A, and the world left them way behind. And they eventually went out of business. You know, the great Harvard philosopher Nozick, who passed away a few years ago, he had this distinction between what he called a local maximum and a global maximum. And in context, he was trying to express the difference between Hill A, which is very good, and Hill B, which is much better, you know. And I was talking about these two hills to a group of insurance people once, and this president of the company, he said something like, out loud, like something like, oh no. And I said, what? And he said, there's bound to be a hill C and a hill D and a hill E and a hill. And I said to this guy, Lauren, his name was Lauren Patch. I said, Lauren, don't be depressed. That's something to be excited about, right? Yeah. That we can always learn and grow, and there's something out there. So the leaders who try to keep us in place and try to keep us pacified are not leaders at all. The true leaders are the people who are scouting out the horizon for the next hill. And they want to prepare us to launch into that new adventure so that we can all flourish better together.
It's such a wonderful story. It actually reminds me of the distinction between two philosophers who I know you are aware of, Hegel and Kierkegaard.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
More different, it would be hard to find two philosophers that are more different than them. I often, when I teach this to my students, will say, look, Hegel is what it's like philosophizing from a mountaintop.
Yeah.
You can see everything, you can survey everything, and then your whole story, your whole narrative is about how great you are because there is no other hill upon which one would want to stand. Yeah. And I say Kierkegaard, alternatively, he has this almost Hamiltonian-esque, people who are fans of the Broadway musical, you know, this scrappy kind of hungry sort of account, yeah, where it's philosophizing while on the side of the mountain, not sure if you're going to be able to get through the clouds to see the tip of the top.
Yeah.
And there's something about that resonates with me as a finite human, where we can't see where we're headed perfectly, hence the risk, hence the trust.
Mm-hmm.
And yet it's those who are able to rally those around them and say, you know what? We may fall off the mountain, but we do know that behind us is nothing but valley.
Yeah.
Onward and upward, right?
I love that. All these images I love to think in images as a philosopher, right? Because in my book, The Oasis Within, toward the end of the book, a character says, the older character, my Gandalf, my Dumbledore, says to this young guy, they're talking about uncertainty, and he says a sentence that just shocked me. He said, consider the possibility that uncertainty is a gift. And when I heard my character say that, I thought, what in the world could that possibly mean, right? We want things to be normal and ordinary and predictable. We want to know what's going to happen an hour from now and tomorrow and the next day. Uncertainty, it creates anxiety and worry and fear. And so he goes on in the book, he explains this, that uncertainty is kind of the open field of possibilities. Mm-hmm. And insofar as uncertainty is darkness, it's within those darkness that we can identify those who carry light.
Yeah.
And it's within that darkness that we can learn to shine our own light for the benefit of other people as well as ourselves. That times of uncertainty can be times of great self-knowledge. Times of uncertainty can be times of great self-cultivation. And they can be times of amazing creativity and innovation when we get off hill A. Or like, I love the Kierkegaard and Hegel analogy. Didn't Kierkegaard at one point describe Hegel as like a person who creates this huge high mansion and then lives in a little outhouse out back? You know, he can't really live in the loftiness of the edifice he's created. Yeah. And we live in a time where a lot of people with these fantastical, grandiose career ambitions have built all these edifices that are no good for anybody. I mean, I was learning, I've just recently written a book based on Mary Shelley's novel, Frankenstein. Which I think is the greatest cautionary tale on success ever written. Here's a smart guy, Victor Frankenstein, brilliant guy. He does everything that the success motivational folks say that we ought to do. He sets a clear goal. He has a strong confidence. He does all this stuff. And he creates a monster that he can't control. He unleashes on the world a deadly monster he can't control. Well, now think about that as an image for the financial crisis of 2007, 2008, and beyond. What we're even going through now. Now, how about all the problems in Facebook that Mark Zuckerberg has faced? How about all the problems with social media? How about all the problems with modern technology? Yep. All these brilliant people with grandiose ambitions sometimes create, not just on a big scale, but we want to even avoid in our own lives, creating monsters we can't control, right? And so Mary Shelley, as a woman who philosophized through stories, has a lot to teach us to move away from those Hegelian grandiose leaders, so-called leaders, right? To then follow those scrappy guys like Kierkegaard, who are great guides for the existential turmoil of life, which can lead us into joy. I think the Stoics were so wise, especially Seneca. He saw that he thought of joy as our birthright, and he wanted to eliminate everything that got in our way of that birthright, because most of the stuff that keeps us from being joyful is stuff we impose on ourselves. An external circumstance doesn't necessarily have to make you fearful or anxious or where you decide to react that way. Now, it could feel very natural, but you can train yourself not to, right? So when the philosophers bring us all these kinds of tools and techniques for real living, I say, thank goodness I'm a philosopher, right? Because it's physician heal myself all the time in my house.
That's right. Maybe this is a wonderful place to bring our conversation to a close, because we started with you saying, as a professor of philosophy of religion, you started recognizing that all of these people were clamoring for the wisdom that had always been there, right? For the Michael Jordans of human existence to teach them how to do some dunks.
Yeah.
And where we've ended now with your last answer was, we have yet to get any further than the Socratic claim we should be really invested in knowing ourselves.
That's right.
That has never changed, despite the fact that, you know, we socially couldn't be further from Socrates, and yet the task remains, right?
This is
why it's so good to talk to you. It's why I'm so glad you're doing what you're doing. And so, Tom, thank you so much for being with us today. I really think this episode in particular will bring some encouragement and hope to all of us as we try our best to figure out, well, shoot, we're in a valley. What mountaintops might begin to emerge? And so I appreciate that and would climb up any of them with you, man. Thank you.
Well, man, I want to say to you, Aaron, I can't think of a better partner for this adventure of self-knowledge, man. Thank you for helping me so much think through things in new ways with the videos you do every day and just all the service you provide to the world. It's been fun to be with you in this kind of context. Let's do it again sometime.
Sounds great. Thank you. And for everybody else, thank you so much for watching today. It's a wonderful opportunity to be able to think together. And despite the fact that we're all isolated in our homes, thankfully, we find ourselves in a world where technology allows us to still see each other's faces and to receive encouragement from people like Tom Morris. So as we say on Two Philosophers, One Conversation, that philosophy has always been about the public good. And today you got a really good sense of how that works and why that is true. And so with Tom, with me, let's all do our best to continue making meaning in light of the fact that we are mortal beings. We'll see you next time.